Good morning, and welcome home. I'm so glad everyone is here for Homecoming Sunday. We're delighted to have Tom Sweets back in the pulpit, so I'm really looking forward to this. We've also been really blessed to have a guest pianist with us, and I'm going to ask music director Roy Swanson, after he is done changing his out of his organ shoes, or changing into his organ shoes. I don't know. Okay. These are your walking. These shoes are made for walking. Walk on over and introduce our pianist to us.
Good morning, everyone. Nice to see everybody today. I'd like to introduce to you, or maybe reintroduce to you, a pianist who I understand was the pianist here at the church several years ago, or many years ago. And her name is Mari Nishihata Wheelhouse. Did I get that right? You may recall that back in July we had a piano recital here, and this was Mari's piano studio that played here. So in return, she's agreed to play for a service for us. So welcome, Mari. Great to have you here.
Welcome back, Mari. Great to have you here. Okay, so we are about to get underway, but before we do, I'm going to invite you to take out your In the Life of the Church insert. While you're doing that, good morning to all of you who are joining us on Facebook, and we are really glad that you are here. Something new that we have that we're running as an experiment for the next month or so. We've got an online worship resources for you, so you can go to our church website, and you'll see the online resources where you can download the bulletin, you can download some information about the various announcements we're going to talk about. So go to our website and look for the online resources. It's under the easily accessible under the current news item there. Okay, a couple of things to point out. We are continuing our drive for supplies for the Maui wildfire victims. So we are partnering with our partners over at Matthew 25 Ministries, and our deacons are leading this. So you see all of the stuff right in there that Matthew 25 Ministries can use. Feel free to bring those in by next week. You can bring them by the church office anytime during the week. And if you're coming by after hours, we have a bin conveniently set up over by the office doors. You can just leave them in there and we will get them to Matthew 25 Ministries. Larry Lewis has already taken several carloads of stuff over there, including 24 cans of Spam. So I was really excited to see the Spam. I just thought that was awesome. Okay, also coming up, the Missions Committee. Missions Committee has been super active trying to promote and educate us about the various missionaries that this church supports. We've got two brunch and learn opportunities coming up this month. So Sunday, September 10th, we have the City Gospel Mission with Gary Lumens from the City Gospel Mission, who's going to come and educate us a little bit more about the ministry and the work of the City Gospel Mission. That'll be very informative. Again, the 10 o'clock hour between the services is when Gary's going to give his presentation, but he will speak briefly in both worship services. And then the following Sunday, September 17th, Mark and Sarah Covell will be with us. And for those of you who are relatively new, Sarah grew up in this church. And so it's really cool to welcome them back. It's kind of neat to see things coming full circle. Somebody who grew up here, was nurtured here, and is now serving with CRU, formerly Campus Crusade for Christ. She's serving with Athletes in Action. Mark is serving as a church planting catalyst with CRU Church Movements. So some very exciting work they're doing there. You don't want to miss it. Again, Brunch and Learn, September 17th, during the 10 o'clock hour, but they will have brief presentations in both worship services. Finally, take note, we are doing the butterfly release on September 9th for those who have lost loved ones over the course of the year. Or, you know, it would be appropriate if you are deeply moved by the loss of life and some of the recent tragedies, be it the Maui wildfires or the California floods or other places. It would be very appropriate if that would help you in your processing of that to participate in the butterfly release. But we do need you to RSVP if you're going to want to release some butterflies. We have a sign-up sheet in the entry foyer, or you can email us at the church office and just let us know that you're coming to participate. Okay, all the rest you can take a look at your leisure, but we are here to worship. We are here to turn our hearts and minds to Jesus Christ, the author and perfecter of our faith. And so let us join our voices together on this responsive call to worship. So join with me. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good and his love endures forever.
Let the
Some wandered in desert wastelands, finding no way to a city where they could settle. They were hungry and thirsty, and their lives ebbed away.
Let
He led them by a straight way to a city where they could settle.
Let them give thanks to the Lord for something they can love, and his wonderful.
For he satisfies the thirsty and fills the hungry with good things. Let the one who is wise heed these things and ponder the loving deeds of the Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, as you are able, let's stand and let's join our voices together on our opening hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise, number 48.
God, we are so glad to be able to sing hymns to your praise, to celebrate you. We are so grateful that you are our Father, that you are thoughtful, that you care for us, and that you provide for us. We thank you, Lord, that you are in the heavens and over all, and you watch us and lead us and care for us. And it is our hunger today that your kingdom would come throughout the earth, that the kingdom of Jesus, of grace and peace, of healing and forgiveness, would sweep this world, that you would drive out the darkness. We are so glad for what your Spirit is doing. We are glad to participate in it, and we long for that which is yet to come. Lord, as we come to you this morning, we're conscious that there's climate chaos around us right now. There's floods in California and burnt buildings and dead people who've lost their lives in Maui. There's fires in Canada, floods in California. Just the world feels climactically chaotic. In the midst of all this, we pray for your compassion and your care and your resources and your provision. And we pray that throughout the world, people would bow their knees and call out to you, who alone can bring good out of bad and light in the midst of darkness. We call out to you, Lord, for blessing and care and compassion on those who need it. We come to you, Lord, with the prayer that you gave us to pray together, as we all say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. When we come to the Lord, we acknowledge that he's righteous and we aren't, that he's God and that we are not, and we're conscious that we step over the boundaries that he set for us and we fail to live up to his expectations for us as we fail to live up to our own expectations. And so it's appropriate as the people of God to come with confession, which allows us to embrace in fresh new ways the wonder of Jesus' death on the cross to cleanse us from our sins. So let us join together in this unison prayer of confession printed in our worship guide. Let us all say together, Merciful God, we confess that we remain preoccupied with ourselves, separated from our brothers and sisters in Christ. We cling to destructive habits, hold grudges, and show reluctance to welcome one another. We allow the past to hold us hostage. In your loving kindness, have mercy on us and free us from our sin. Remind us of the promises you make in baptism so that we may arise to new life and live together in grace. Amen. Well, let me assure you that God forgives you eagerly. We're in a study on Friday mornings on 1 Peter, and Peter talks about all these wonderful qualities in the Christian life. And then he says, if you lack these qualities, it's because you've lost perspective, that your past sins have been forgiven. So let us remind ourselves again today that in Jesus Christ, because of his death on the cross, your sins are forgiven, past, present, and future. What a wonder that is. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Of Jesus Christ, called by his Spirit to belong to him and to each other. We acknowledge that through the ritual of passing of the peace. Let's turn now and pass the peace of Jesus to each other.
And while we are settling down here in the sanctuary, my, what a lively crowd we have in the sanctuary today. They're not listening to me at all, are they? Well, in theory, while we are settling down here in the sanctuary, all of us say to all of you online, the peace of Christ be and abide with you. May his peace abide with you now and forevermore. Amen. I'm not even sure if they heard me say that with all this. Take it away, Todd.
Good morning. Our first scripture reading today comes from Isaiah 53, verses 4 through 6. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Before we get to the congregational song, let me just take a moment of personal privilege here, because one thing I omitted during the announcement time, but now everyone's here, so we can talk about it. I do hope you are staying after the worship service. We do have lunch that has been prepared by our scripture reading, Chef Boy Hardy. These are the jokes, and his team of chefing professionals. And so we've got an Italian lunch that is being prepared for you. Missy and her team of professionals have put together a ministry fair, team of professionals of many of our ministry leaders from all across the church. So you'll have an opportunity to see some of the many things that are going on in the church and how you can participate and be a part of that. So I do hope you're planning on hanging around afterwards. You'll also get the opportunity for a little one-on-one time with this guy. So it's going to be a great time. I do hope you were staying. Oh, yes. And of course, the other neat thing, if you haven't had a chance yet, be sure to duck through the kitchen. I guess you're going to have to go through the kitchen to get food, right? You'll go through the kitchen. And if you haven't seen the results of our recent kitchen refresh project, I predict that you will be amazed because painters young and old have participated greatly. and painters, constructors, did I just invent a word? It has been very exciting to watch this unfold, and I trust that you will enjoy that. Okay, so brothers and sisters, let us now continue our worship by joining together on this congregational song as chapter 28 leads us in By the Grace of God.
Please stand. The words are in your bulletin, also on the screen.
When the mountains
Thank you. You may be seated. Today's second scripture reading comes from Matthew, chapter 6, verses 5 through 15. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand, pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have not received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others of their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. This is the word of the Lord.
And now we come to the time of the service where we receive tithes and offerings. But just as a reminder, I'm always inviting you to be pondering and considering how God is calling you to offer of your time and your talent and your gifts for the building of the kingdom. This week, God will give you opportunities to be his instrument of blessing, of praise, of proclamation. And I invite you to be open to being a vessel, to being a channel of his Holy Spirit working through you. Brothers and sisters, prayerfully consider, how might God be working through you this week? Let's receive the tithe and the offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Mighty God, Holy One, you are the provider of everything, and we return these tithes and offerings unto you. We ask that you would build your kingdom. We also ask that you would grow within each of us the fruit of the Spirit. Give us the gifts of faith and hope and love, and help us to exhibit and demonstrate that faith, hope, and love every day of this week, so that you might be glorified and praised through our lives. So Lord, into your hands we commit these tithes and offerings. We commit our very selves as instruments of your praise. In the name of Jesus Christ, we offer these prayers. Amen. You may be seated.
Today's final scripture comes to us from Colossians chapter 3, verses 7 through 17. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were all called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. This is the word of the Lord.
So I get a rare privilege that I get to relinquish this pulpit and go sit with Tammy during this worship service. I also get the delight and joy of welcoming Tom Sweets back. Tom, what was it, 24 years, 25 years? 25 years. Tom, for those of you who are relatively new with us, Tom was pastor here for 25 years. When I came to Cincinnati back in 2001, you know, and received as a Presbyterian minister by the local governing body, Tom was one of the first people that greeted me after I was received. And those of you who know and love Tom, you know that that's an experience. Tom is a larger-than-life figure. I mean, every so often, God brings some of these larger-than-life figures into your life, and I was so blessed to meet a man of such energy, optimism, enthusiasm, just relentless commitment to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And over the years, you know, as I passing through Madeira, I'm sure many of you had this experience as well. You know, I'd stop by and again, Russell, come on into my office, sit down, let's talk, how are things going? And I'm sure many of you have had that experience as well. You get invited to sit down by that round table, and 50 minutes, an hour and a half later, you feel refreshed in his presence. Tom, you're a gift, brother, and it is a delight to welcome you and Karen back. I'm getting all maudlin here, so I'm just going to leave the rest of the worship service into his hands, and brother, bring us the word.
Thanks, Russell. Good to be back. Good to be back, and good to see everyone, and just
Russell, you know, when you'd come by and we'd talk for an hour and a half, I should have been working on my sermon probably, but it is good. It's good to connect. It's so great to be up here this morning and to see everybody and to think of, to think a little bit, my goodness, there are weddings out here and there are children that are baptized and, you know, there are weddings and then baptisms. There are people that have come into the church and built the church. There are Sunday school classes and retreats and just the joy of being together. Days working outside, improving the grounds, and there's just connection as I look out and I see all of you. It's so good to be here. I really want it as I think just personally think back about my time here. And first of all, thank you, and thank you for 25 years. It was amazing. I never would have guessed it. I really thought I'd come here for 3 or 4 years and then go into the next church that wanted me, but no one else wanted me. So thanks for thanks for keeping me. But the last day we had here, that celebration was just an amazing day. God blessed it. You blessed it. You affirmed me in that day. I just don't know that. I just feel like there may be maybe just a handful of people in this life get such a day when you get so affirmed for the time together. And of course, that time together, there are joys and there are triumphs and there's some difficulties. We're going to be talking a little bit about that because the theme of the sermon today is going to be on forgiveness. And of course, you know, as people, we cannot get along together unless there is forgiveness. And why is that? That's because none of us are perfect. And the one person that was perfect, of course, taught us the most about forgiveness. So we're going to think about that today. But it's so good to look out and see you. It's so good to see the church and just feel all that connection and the richness. I'm so glad that in my life I didn't pop around to different places for 3 or 4 years here and 3 or 4 years there. I'm so glad it was here and that we were together. And thanks for your love and your understanding during all that time. Really appreciate it. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, I pray that you would open your word to us today and bless us and let us grow in you and love you more this day by what we know and learn and share. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, I want to begin today that the topic is forgiveness. We're going to center really on the challenge and the instruction of the Lord's Prayer. And I want to begin today by saying this. The church, and only the church, has the ideas and the means to save people and unite our society. As we watch, in many instances and many things in society collapse around us with silly ideas and dramatic pronouncements that are changed the next week, we realize the majesty of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We realize the beauty of the church that lasts through all kinds of foolishness and bad ideas. Do you realize that in this church, in your church, you have the ideas that save the world? And they're ideas that work every time they're tried. They're ideas that have worked for thousands of years. They're ideas that God has given to us. The Ten Commandments, the Sermon on the Mount, the Lord's Prayer, the command to forgive. So do you realize that you hold in your possession the very thoughts that everyone that lives around you needs? The truth and the ideas that they need to see. And that through your life, you're living that out before them day by day. And it's a challenge, isn't it? It's not the easiest thing in the world. So today we're going to focus on forgiveness. I think it was the topic I preached on for my last sermon. It's just where God has been working with me. And forgiveness is one of the most important characteristics of the Christian life. You know, the definition of love in 1 Corinthians 13 begins with this phrase, love is patient. Love is patient. And of course, to be patient with someone, we need to be what? Forgiving and understanding. The Christian life begins with forgiveness. We realize we're sinners. And through the teaching and preaching of the church, we realize that God, through Christ, has made forgiveness available to us. He was punished for our iniquity, and he died for our sin, as Isaiah says. And by faith, we receive that gift. And we not only have fellowship with God, we enter the kingdom of God when we receive that gift of forgiveness from God. And then what's the next logical step? Then we become forgiving towards other people. That's exactly, and God wants us to live it out. The gift he gave us, he wants us to give to others. The gift he gave you, that gift of forgiveness, he's going to look at you as a pure and righteous person despite your mistakes, those that you did deliberately and not deliberately. God is going to forgive you, and he has forgiven you through Christ Jesus. And now we, led by the Holy Spirit, are to go out into the world, and our witness is that we are forgiving people. It's not something that is natural, is it? It's something that must be learned and must be practiced. It is so important that Jesus put it right in the middle of the Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer that connects us to God, and the prayer that makes us right with God every day. Six sections. Our Father, honoring God, we're worshiping God. The second section, may your kingdom come and may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. May your purpose be worked out in my life. Now this gets down to the next thing is what we think about. Give us this day our daily bread. It's important. We have to have food and shelter and warmth in order to live. Lord, provide for us. Now, once we're provided for, forgive us our debts is the hard part, as we forgive our debtors. It's the only part of the prayer where the onus is put on us. We're saying, God, as I pray to you, may you be as forgiving to me as I am to others. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So God, you know, protect me in this task. And then final, and worship again, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Now, just in case we were going to miss the point that the entire center of the Lord's Prayer is centered in forgiveness, then what are the two verses that come after Jesus taught us the Lord's Prayer in Matthew? It says this, for if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But, wish it didn't have that but in there. This is where the power comes. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Now, no one is saying here that forgiveness is easy. Matter of fact, you can't forgive without it costing you money or time or grief or difficulty. It's impossible. You cannot forgive unless it costs you. But in this prayer where we're pointing to the power of God, the focus is that we share one important work with God in order for the church to work, and that is forgiveness. So I thank you. I thank each of you that are here today for your forgiveness of me, for the times I did whatever things I did, possibly preached too long on a Sunday or two. Maybe ignored you. I remember one time a lady left the church, and she was in her 80s, and I went to stop by her house to visit with her, And I said, I'm so sorry that I must have done something to touch you. Yes, she said, you ignored me in the narthex. I remember the day there must have been 100 people in that narthex and someone's waving at me from the other side. And I walked past her and she thought, you know, I'm like ignoring her, whatever. I mean, these things happen. I said, I'm so sorry. Would you forgive me? Forgiveness is difficult because it always costs us if we hurt someone's feelings. But forgiveness is also learned. This is, by the way, why we go to church every Sunday. It isn't like you just get it. Oh, yeah, I got that down and I've learned. No, it's a lifetime of learning. It's a lifetime of going deeper. That's why Jesus put it in the middle of the Lord's Prayer. And that's why he followed it up that saying, you know, if you get this forgiveness part right, you will be forgiven. But if you don't get it right, watch out. I want to tell you this. It is natural to be upset with people. It's natural to think poorly about them. It's natural to notice the ways they have hurt you. It's natural to notice how they have disappointed you. That's all natural. It's supernatural when you forgive. It's hard to underestimate the radical nature of the true God of heaven revealed in this world. And it's also hard to overestimate the importance of getting that message out into the world, because our world is operating with a bunch of bad ideas as it tries to operate from a secular perspective, from a perspective without God. By the way, when people operate from a perspective without God, do you know who God is? Well, God's where you put your time, it's where you put your money, it's where you put your emphasis. Where is that? Oh, God ends up being moi, me. That's what God ends up being, right? But if there is a true God of heaven, now Abraham got this promise from God, and do you realize at the time of Abraham, all the way, I think we could say all the way to the Middle Ages, falsely called the Dark Ages by historians, but to the Middle Ages, because it was in the Middle Ages that the church took root and truly transformed all of society. And if you don't believe it, go look at the cathedrals. Karen and I just got back from a little 8-day trip to London, every day we were in churches. The awesome beauty of what people have done through the years for the Lord. But what was the idea of God? What was the idea of God at the time of Abraham and all the way to 1,000 years ago? The idea of God in the world was this. We have a God in our community. You know, and if it's Athens, we had the god Athena. If it's Ephesus, it was the goddess Diana. If it was Thessaloniki, it was Zeus on Mount Olympus. And everyone had their god. And you had your particular god from your particular area. If it was Phoenicia, it was the Phoenician god. And you had your god. And you worshiped your god. And your army defended your god. And what happened when your army was killed? And your village was burned, that God disappeared. That was the idea of God through all of time until God revealed himself to Abraham and said, Abraham, I am your God, and I'm going to make you into a blessing, and the whole world will be blessed through you. A living, personal God. Now, we've lived with this concept so long, we just think that's what was there. What was there is that there was Jupiter, there was Mercury, there were these different gods, and not a God. But the idea revealed from the God of heaven is that he was in heaven, he was God, and when the children of Israel left Egypt, then he gave them the Ten Commandments. Just another way, how do we understand this God? And not only is there a God, and by the way, there's a beautiful little series. If you like doing podcasts, Hillsdale College has a series called Ancient Christianity, and it lays out this whole thing about, you know, who do we compete with ideas? So in the world is, it's either my village has a God or my town has a God or my city has a God. Not that we turn sports teams into that or anything, but you know, there's that idea. And that my ego is tied up in the God of my city. And that was the idea. And then, but through the God's revelation through Abraham and Moses and David, the idea we began to understand, no, there's a real and living and personal God, and we can have a relationship with that God. Now, just to give you a little example, we were at a former temple from Roman times in Bath, England. Bath, England is named after the baths. There are hot springs there, like French Lick, Indiana, and all over the world. There are hot springs there, and the Romans built a huge pool so they could go bathe in the hot springs, a place for recreation. And they put in steam rooms and massage rooms and everything else. And of course, there was a temple there. And at the temple, you could come and worship God. Well, what would you do to worship God at that temple? You think you'd come and pray and say, oh, God, forgive me, for I'm a sinner. And oh, God, help me. And I'm weak, but you are strong. Is that what you would do at that temple? No. At the bottom of the pool, after they did excavations and renovations and rebuilt this, they rebuilt the temple in about 1897, and it's now a beautiful place to visit. But they found little lead or tin pieces of metal about that size, about 3-4 inches wide and about 2 inches high, and people inscribed their prayers on that metal and threw it in the pool so that the gods would answer them. And what were their prayers? Here's prayer, here's problem. The person who has stolen my bronze pot is utterly accursed. This is the name of the culprit that has stolen my bracelet. The theft of a pair of gloves. The worshiper was Docetimus, and they suggest that the person that stole their gloves should lose his mind and his eyes. The theft of 6 silver coins. Curse the Christians and pagans as possible thieves. What they found, the prayers they found in the bottom of the pools of water in Bath, all the prayers were curses. Now, what's that reveal to you about the person praying? They want to curse other people out there. You cross me, it's coming back to you, and I'm going to make sure of it. They're talking to God. All the prayers they found were connected with curses towards other people. Why? Because that's what's natural. What is unnatural is forgiveness. We really don't forgive because someone asked us to forgive. If we wait on someone to ask us to forgive, we wouldn't forgive 90% of the people in our life. We don't forgive because someone has asked us to forgive. We forgive because we're taught by Christ to forgive. And because we're sinners and we have received forgiveness, we know we must pass it on. I was recently dealing with someone in an issue of forgiveness, and they called me up and they said, hey, you need to forgive me. I said, no problem, it's nothing. You didn't do anything wrong. No, you didn't. I said, okay, I will forgive you. To which they then added, you know, I know you're not totally responsible for this. Hold it, I thought, yeah, anyway. We don't hold curses towards other people, including if they took money from us. I know that's getting personal. We don't make curses our prayers. What did Jesus say? Bless those who have wounded you. What did he say on the cross? The most intense moment of his life, the greatest moment for learning. There are soldiers down there that have spit on him and made fun of him and run him through with a spear, and they're gambling to steal his clothes. And what is Jesus' prayer? He is thinking compassionately about that. Well, this guy's just a Roman soldier. He just signed up for the pension. That's what Jesus is thinking of the people killing him. He doesn't know what he's doing. He doesn't understand that the whole weight of human history pivots around this moment, and he's throwing dice in the most important moment of all of human history. He doesn't say that. What's he say? Father, forgive him, for he doesn't know what he's doing. Now, we can take that prayer, can't we? Can we use that prayer with our children? Can we use that prayer with our spouses or with our parents? Can we use that prayer with students we teach in school or patients we have in the office? Can we use that prayer with good friends? Can we use that prayer with people when they're older and you have loved them and cared for them and sacrificed for them, but now they're in a little moment of dementia and they say, "You betrayed me." And you say, "Ha, ha, ha." You don't really know what you're saying. Father, forgive them. They do not know what they are doing. I'm so impressed with the church. It is the greatest organization of human history. I'm impressed with the church done well. And Russell, good job. And Madeira Silverwood, good job. And just keep loving each other and keep the doors open for those that want to come in. We can't force them in any way, can we? But we just keep the doors open. And if they want to love about forgiveness, they're going to find out from you and me. And they will come in, and it'll be the greatest discovery they've ever had. Karen and I went on our first day to Salisbury, and we went in Salisbury Cathedral, and here's an inscription on the tomb. A 48-year-old man died, and his brother was the canon of the cathedral. He was the head priest at the cathedral, and this is 1735. And then he wrote on his brother's tombstone, "Beloved for the gentleness of his temper and the suavity of his manners, virtuous and religious from principle, and preferring the calm pleasures of study to the more active occupations of the military profession. He maintained through his life the character of a good, accomplished man, and died in the faith and the hope of the true Christian." What a beautiful statement. Do you ever feel like, "Well, I haven't done enough in life, or what can I do in life, or I'm never going to be president of the insurance company, or I'm never going to be a great doctor or a lawyer or a professor or whatever else. I'm never going to do any of that." Listen, folks, this is the great Christian life. A life of good character and the accomplishment of faith, the faith of a true Christian. "Therefore, as God's chosen people," Paul writes to those in Colossae, "holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself with compassion." Compassion, that's the first word of forgiveness. We have to understand that other person. Why were they abusive? Well, why is a person abusive? You know the answer? First thing you look up and say, why is a person abusive? Because they were abused. Now, if you look past their abusive talk or conversation to you and think about that, now you have compassion and now you can forgive them. Clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. Oh my goodness, what an amazing and great day we had. Can you believe it was 2 years ago? We had that. Thank you for giving me a celebration of 25 years of ministry. My friend Greg Anderson, who's pastored in Hong Kong and pastored in London, and he's now on staff at Wheaton College, And he's served in probably in a church in Dayton and South Dakota. He's about as well exposed as anybody I know to the whole world of Christ. He said, "Tom, I've never seen a day like it. Thank you," because it's all about saying, "We love you, we respect you, even though there are a number of things we need to forgive you for." It's true. It's true. You see, the Christian church has the only idea that can save the world. There is no, zero, secular morality that is consistent. Only the revelation of God. And that revelation comes down to his son, Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. Our world plays around with ideas, and they're desperately trying to fix the human condition. And when this year it doesn't work, they switch it next year. Remember this year they told us this was it, or nothing would ever work, and we'd all come to an end. And then this year, well, that we were wrong about that, but now we've got it right. Jesus showed us the real way. Our world is actually given to totalitarian concepts. If people don't obey, you rule it over them and you lock them up. Jesus shows us that if we follow his example, we heal all social ills. Our world creates a dynamic of heroes and villains and seeks to curse the villains, like those little prayers in Bath, England. The Bible says we're all sinners and we've all fallen short of the glory of God. But God wants to forgive you, and he loves you through his son, Jesus Christ. There is nothing you have done that cannot be forgiven. And yet, I am forgiving you, says the scripture. And all I'm saying is you become a forgiving person to others. And folks, that's the only plan that Jesus has for changing the world. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your church and for the love shown and expressed and lived, given in hugs and well wishes on birthdays, in prayers and concerns and hospital visits and meetings and Bible studies and just a smile. Thank you that it lives here and set the world aflame with that love and forgiveness that is ours through your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our final hymn is number 66, "To God Be the Glory."